Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 2020 OFC General Chairs, Robert Overspike, Daniel Kukta, and William Xie.
Good morning, and thank you. On behalf of the IEEE Communications Society, the IEEE Photonics Society, and the Optical Society, we welcome you to OFC 2020, the world's premier optical communications networking event. This year, we have an exciting program of technical sessions, live demonstrations, special events, and celebrations, commemorating major milestones in the history of fiber communications. In addition to its program, OFC also offers a way for us to connect with colleagues across disciplines and geographic boundaries, as well as forge new relationships with fellow attendees. This year, OFC brings together many thousands of researchers, engineers, technology experts, and business leaders who are shaping the global enterprise in optics and photonics. While we are thankful for all who were able to make it here, we miss having many of our colleagues and regret they are unable to attend in person to present their research and products. We're sending our best wishes, and I speak to the camera, to all those impacted by the coronavirus, and look forward to reconnecting with them at OFC 2021. For our colleagues who cannot be here in person, we have made efforts, many efforts, for their research to be presented and for them to have extended video access after the conference. In addition, for the first time, and I'll repeat that, for the first time, OFC has taken innovative steps to enable remote two-way participation using a web conferencing and collaboration system. This allows us to offer virtual attendance options for most technical sessions. For those of us here in person, rest assured that we are following the guidance from worldwide health organizations and experts. We are fully committed to taking appropriate precautions to provide a safe and healthy environment for attendees. We truly appreciate all of you joining us to chart the course of the future of optical communications. Dan?
Thanks, Bob. I too would like to express the same sentiment towards our colleagues who could not be here today, and I look forward to seeing you in person at OFC 2021 in San Francisco. In my opinion, it's the in-person interactions that are the best aspect of OFC. My own work has benefited from participating in OFC over the years. No matter what, you learn something new, but just as importantly, you make new connections and you renew the old ones. Personally, I've formed some of my best collaborative works through relationships that I've made here at OFC. In addition to bringing us together, OFC focuses on how we collectively are advancing our field. This conference showcases a wide array of those technologies that are shaping research and development in dozens of high-impact areas. From the latest development in 5G communications and data center technologies to quantum information and machine learning, OFC draws together emerging solutions that continue to change the future of our field. Together, we are advancing our industry, and it's great to have this opportunity to interact with all of you and explore what's next.
Thanks, Dan. Many of the innovations that Dan mentioned are featured in the OFC exhibitions. OFC has hundreds of exhibitors and sponsors highlighting product in the market today. Every company here presents a product that work to advance our industry and strengthen opportunities with optical communications. So let us take a moment to thank all our exhibitors and sponsors. You help make sure OFC is the world leading show for optical communications. The show floor opens immediately after this session. Please stop by to discover new solutions.
Thank you, Bill. Before we hear our first plenary speaker, we want to take a moment to thank the entire OFC program committee, especially the technical program chairs, and you'll hear from one of them today, Sinji Matsu, David Plant, and Jun Shan Wei. They are responsible for the expansive program you are experiencing this week. Each member of this committee has given countless hours to building the technical conference, and we're greatly indebted to their dedication and hard work. Please join me in thanking them for making this event a success. There's one thing I'd like to add as a side note. I would like to do a special thank you to our plenary speakers. They made an extraordinary commitment to get here in person. And so let's give them a round before they even speak today. Thank you.
And now it's time to move on to our plenary speakers. Each year, the General Chair surveyed trend in the global optics and photonic community to find the most engaging topics of interest to our attendees. This year, we're delighted to have three outstanding speakers. The first is a world-class pioneer in optical fiber technologies, Professor Sir David Pan, whose contribution shaped where the field is heading and what new innovations and challenges lie ahead. Sir David is a leading professor at the University of Southampton and the director of the Optoelectronics Research Center. His work in fiber fabrications in the 70s resulted in almost all the special fibers in use today. Most importantly, the vast transmission capacity of today's internet results directly from the urban doped fiber amplifier invented by Sir David and his team, as well as simultaneously by the Bell Lab teams in the 1980s. Today, Sir David will give us insights into how he sees alternative fiber designs and fiber lasers addressing our capacity and other important issues. Please join me in welcoming Professor Sir David Pan.
Good morning, everybody. You diehards that are here in the audience, welcome. And I am told hundreds to thousands, perhaps, online listening, hopefully, to me to give this talk. So I've controversially called this talk, "Is There a Future for Silica as an Optical Material?" So silica is my favorite material. I'm going to tell you why. And I'm going to run through some of the latest developments. But before doing that, I asked myself a question. Why me for this really, really important plenary talk? And so I kind of give some thought to that. And I've been in this field since 1967. Early fiber growth, 1972. I was the fifth Tyndall Award in 1991, and I had a look at the previous four to me, and I discovered that most of them are now retired, with the exception of Tom Giolorenzi, who I met just a moment ago, who tells me that he's 1 year older than me. So we're going to have a fight about that. So obviously it wasn't that. So I thought a little bit more about that. I thought, well, you know, the UK at the moment is in the news, not always for good reasons. So Brexit happened about a month ago. Well, except for the negotiations, they'll go on for another 20 years. So maybe that was part of it. Maybe the controversy about that was something that we needed to talk about. We've also had a few controversies in the royal family recently. So, you know, perhaps that was a factor as well. And maybe it was the market opportunity, because despite the fact that the UK, in the early days of optical fiber, since Charles Cowell's famous paper, was very, very strong and was running next to the US and Japan, neck and neck for the first few years of OFC. So you know, I wondered about that. Why have we ended up with the lowest fiber to the home penetration in the EU? So you know, that was a disappointment to me. Perhaps it was because Southampton is very close to Salisbury. And Salisbury houses one of the original copies of the Magna Carta that you see there, which was written in 1215, and it was the first document to establish that the monarch was not above the law, something that some of our former colonies seem to be having a little trouble with at the moment. So, you know, there we are. The relevance of this I will show you towards the end, because we have written this famous document into some of our 5D memory, and I'll be talking about that later. Okay, so let's get into it. You know this better than I do, the global internet is optical. So this conference has always tracked and been the bellwether, if you like, for what's happening in the community. And the community is changing. New markets are opening up using the similar technology. And I'm going to cover a few of those, just so perhaps if you haven't noticed. And we ask a couple of questions. Did Charles Kao get it right when he predicted that it should be silica? And can we keep up with the global demand, which continues to grow at enormous pace? So the capacity crunch, as it's sometimes called, it's all about the cost, of course. And a couple of observations. You could install more fiber. At 0.5 cents a meter, who cares? You could put more cores in the fiber. Is this significantly cheaper at the system level? So an observation, the cost of a fiber is largely in the core. So putting more cores in doesn't actually save you very much. Saves you some duct space, perhaps. So we could look for alternatives to silica. And we are doing that. We have a number of different glass compositions that we're looking at, mostly, though, for these other markets, that is, the infrared and the ultraviolet, driven by such things as sensing, quantum technologies, which I will touch on. And we can actually beat silica in many of these new areas. So one of the things that I would like to achieve with my team is to make the ultraviolet and the infrared just as easy as we, the community, have made 1550 nanometers. So we have to ask ourselves better materials, what about polymer fibers, new structures, all of which is going on. And perhaps the most famous of these is the observation that vacuum is the very best optical material that we know. But of course, we need guidance, and so the hollow core fiber, microstructured fiber, provides that. And here are some of the designs, but I wanted you to stand back a little bit and think about how disruptive this technology could be, because it breaks all the rules. So, incredibly low nonlinearity. What does that mean to everybody? Well, you guys struggle against nonlinearity all the time, I know that. 30% lower latency. That's because it's a vacuum. Low dispersion across a wide range spectral window. Perhaps you didn't know this, very high damage thresholds. You can put kilowatts over kilometers through this stuff. Think about that. It's radiation hard for space applications. The temperature coefficient of phase group delay can be near zero or even zero. And that ties to a talk that you'll be hearing a little later. And you'd expect all of that from a vacuum, wouldn't you? But what perhaps you haven't thought about, because even the team is constantly finding new applications they hadn't thought about. So let's talk about latency, because again, this ties to a talk that's following mine about the importance of latency and delay. So this is the best way that I can think of demonstrating it. Driverless vehicles. Bum 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 b So it's a scary concept, right? Do you believe that's going to happen? Are you going to walk across one of those crossings there? Knowing that the maximum delay that you can tolerate is about 1 millisecond to achieve what you saw there. So it's really important. And the other place it's really important is in the data center, where information flow, unit area, and latency is key. There's 20,000 kilometers of fiber in one Facebook data center alone. And they really care about the time taken between racks, between boards, even between devices. And so the hollow core fiber is 30% less latency. So if we just look at the data center fiber concept here. So the data rates are increasing from 10 gigabit per second to 40 gigabit per second as we speak. 100 gigabit per second and beyond is what we need. The distances are increasing. They're getting bigger. So 100 meters or more is now not unusual. Silicon photonics is reducing the cost of serial optics, and it needs 1.3 microns. So one of my messages is, don't just think 1550. You know, those of us that have been in this field an awful long time, perhaps our vision's a little too narrow. And we need to think about all of the wavelengths, even down to 900 nanometers, which was the first window that was ever conceived for optical telecoms, is now being used in LiDAR. So it's important that we start to think outside of that box. So we've got Facebook entering to develop single mode fiber optic cabling solutions, and the key question is, what about hollow core? But here's one of those parallel markets that is going to get disrupted as well. So you will be well aware of the optical fiber gyroscope. You see a coil there, and it has a lot of problems with things like what's called Shoup, any traveling wave, temperature, magnetic field, and so on, that traverses the coil creates a bias and an error. So get rid of the core. Use a vacuum. So a lot of industrial applications in motion control, industrial processing, consumer electronics, and so on. And there's a major paper just coming up at the next OFS conference with ourselves and Honeywell on showing a resonant gyro based on hollow core fiber, which is giving exceptional performance and is pointing the way to the future. So the performance is limited by the glass core in the current version, and of course, anti-resonant fibers have very low nonlinearity. It's nonlinearity that creates non-reciprocity, and near zero backscatter, because you don't want to couple the counter-rotating beams. So I couldn't resist giving you a trailer for a post-deadline paper that's coming up. So this is the state of the art in hollow core fiber, 0.28 dBs per kilometer from 1510 to 1600. 3 to 4 orders of magnitude lower nonlinearity than single mode fiber. Orders of magnitude higher power transmission capability, I've pointed that out already. Chromatic dispersion around 2 to 3 picoseconds per nanometer kilometer over several hundred nanometers. And we can now beat the loss of silica at all wavelengths except 1,000 nanometers to 1,700. So that's only twice the loss of standard single mode fiber. So here's the result, which you'll see in the post-deadline paper. So on the right there, you see the reduction in loss that the hollow core anti-resonant fiber in our labs has achieved since 2010. And it looks remarkably like the early days of single mode fiber losses and the speed with which they came down. And you'll also see over there on the left, the actual loss across that very wide range compared to silica, which is on the bottom, so 0.28 dBs per kilometer versus 0.14 dB per kilometer. So if you want to know more about that, go and see the post-deadline paper. But think about this. With that loss, you can achieve half the span that you would typically get from a standard single mode fiber. But this is an interesting point. Or you could put 30 times the input power in and achieve the same span. And you're thinking, gee, how can you do that? Well, remember, this stuff can take kilowatts. So that becomes an option. And you know, think about that and what it means in your application. So what's the barrier to beating silica? Well, very large mode areas. So they're in the region 30-20 microns diameter, and the design requires that. And this leads to bend and microbend loss. Remember that, guys? Back there in the 70s and 80s, that's what we worked on. And so what you've got to do is you've got to develop packaging, buffer layers, cable types, polymer coatings. And of course, I just point out the parallel field of fiber lasers does this all the time. A fiber laser is a highly multi-moded device, and we sneak the lowest order mode down it all the time for tens of meters. So it's not an impossibility. Now, you're thinking, okay, he's going to talk about amplifiers. Well, I have to, don't I? This is the year of the Tyndall. I would encourage you to go and look at the Tyndall exhibition. And also in the foyer, there's a remarkable display of all the Tyndall winners. So I couldn't also resist pointing out that the very first EDFA paper was in January 1987 in Reno at this conference. And there it is, Wednesday, as you can see, the 21st. So let's look at what we've done since then. Because it's remarkable that people are still working on EDFAs, including us. Better compositions, wider bandwidth, better performance, higher efficiency, and so on. But at the same time, remember my mission, which is to have a huge range of different wavelengths, because optical telecoms is not the only game in town. And so here's what's been done with regard to alternative amplifiers, which all of them actually are very similar, if not better, characteristics than the EDFA. And the EDFA, it pains me to say, is actually the limitation to the bandwidth of a typical optical link today. It's just too narrow. But look at that. We've got the thulium doped fiber amplifier, 34 terahertz wide, the holmium doped fiber amplifier out there in the 2-micron region. So don't be scared if the hollow core fiber looks like it might need slightly longer wavelength to operate than standard 1550, because you've got amplifiers there already. So if you look at a newcomer, and this is another paper which is coming up in the post-deadline paper, you may not have even heard of it, the bismuth-doped phosphosilicate fiber. I love this because when I was a student, I invented the phosphosilicate fiber. And because I couldn't afford germanium to put it into the core. So we came up with this alternative dopant, which is phosphosilicate, which nobody ever uses anymore, except in two places. Here, for the bismuth amplifier, and also because it is the solution to photodarkening in high-power fiber lasers. So next lesson, go back and visit your failures, right? There's always an application for them. So you'll see there that there is a dip. That is because there's too much water in here. But don't worry, that will be eliminated. And so now we have an amplifier which has gone from 1340 all the way out to 1480. And if you were to concatenate this with clever schemes, you could make an amplifier that spans 1300 nanometers to 2.1 microns. So that's interesting. Now, you've paid a penalty, but the question is, how important are these things? And only commercial people can answer this. It's 220 meters long. That's just fundamental to this type of amplifier. And it needs somewhere around a watt backward and forward pumping. A watt, that's a lot more than an EDFA, but who cares? We have diodes around that do that stuff. And what you probably didn't know is that an EDFA can give 656 watts of output. So if you want to make a kilowatt telecommunication system, I don't know why you'd want to do that, but if you did, you could do it. And so here's the result. It's a 36-meter long device. We don't actually know how much power it would give out, for the simple reason that we don't have enough diode pumps to take us further than that. But it's quite probable that this could do a kilowatt or two. So speaking of power, we as a community at OFC must surely be aware of all the work that's going on in fiber lasers. So this is a busy slide that I'm going to run through very quickly because it tells you everything you need to know. So there's three ways that you can make a lot of power out of a fiber laser. Made of silica, of course. And this is from my friend Michaelis Zervas, who logs these things. So you can make multimode fibers. That's the top blue curve. And you gain that way. And a lot of applications don't need, or indeed prefer, multimode for cutting because it helps to expel the material out of the curve. You can direct diode pump them, or you can do something which you would never do in conventional lasers. You take one laser, and you pump another laser, and you pump another laser, and so on and so on. And the reason you can do that is because of the very high quantum efficiency of each of the stages, so you don't actually lose out by doing that, which is not the case for conventional lasers. So up to 100 kilowatts of multimode output power have been achieved. That's incoherent combination, so that's just adding them together. For a lot of applications, though, particularly in space or for defense, it's power on target that you care about, and therefore you want a diffraction-limited output. And the current limit is about 30 kilowatts. Calculations show that that could be 50 kilowatts. So a lot of stuff going on there, guys. And this leads us to, this is a very old slide. This is from year 2000. Which showed the concept of taking our technology, our fibers, splitting them up, and making a phase-coherent output beam combined. And built-in steering and adaptive optics like this, which is, we stole this, of course, from microwaves. We do this all the time. And this would then give us, potentially, unlimited power, because there's no limit that we know of today in how many fiber lasers that you could combine together, thousands, maybe even millions. So ask ourselves a question. What does unlimited laser power through fiber laser beam combination yield? We have projects on oil wells for cutting laterals, defense particle accelerators for CERN, laser-driven space propulsion even, anti-drone defense, environmental sensing, maritime, autonomous vehicles, LIDAR, and so on. So there's a whole parallel market out there of people working on this stuff. And that's what a drone looks like if you fly one in places that you're not supposed to fly them. And it leads us, and this is another of our projects, this is more crazy one, which is Breakthrough Starshot, which is a proof of concept project to see whether we could accelerate spacecraft of enormously powerful lasers based on the ground, beam combined to nanosatellites and accelerate them up to half the speed of light. And this is the only known way getting to Alpha Centauri, the star system, which is 4.37 light years away. So is this going to happen? Well, you've got to develop a 10 gigawatt CW fiber laser system. Keeps us all in a job. This is great. Yeah, take your own views on whether that's going to happen. There's certainly a lot of people interested in it. So I need to quickly then also run through another area that I have already introduced to you, which is the concept of cold storage written into silica. I think you're getting a theme here, right? Silica, right? So this is the idea. You take a femtosecond laser, you write little tiny spots, or voxels as we call them, and each voxels can store 8 bits. And the reason for that is position plus birefringence plus orientation. And so you can get a huge storage density because you can use multiple layers, up to 200 layers, and it's been calculated that this could last 10 to the 20 years. We don't say that anymore. We think thousands of years is probably more likely because I'm not going to hang around for 10 to the 20 years to figure it out. So the challenges here are developing the fiber lasers, very low cost. We need to increase the write speed. It's mechanical read and write heads that we currently use, error correction and cassette handling. And so here's how it works.
A powerful laser is fired into the glass in short bursts, creating a grid of nano-sized dots on a single layer. Each dot can have up to 256 variations of shape and orientation, allowing it to contain up to 8 bits of data per dot. Incredibly, these small disks can store over 5 trillion dots. But it can only do that by adding more layers. So far, the team have written over 200 layers into a single piece of glass half a centimeter thick. The man behind this project is Professor Peter Kazansky, who has one of the glass discs to show you.
This is a piece of this glass with a Bible encrypted.
The entire Bible?
Entire.
And is that I can see a slight hazy area, that's the data?
Yes, the data is in the middle, is round shape.
So this is the microscope that can read the data,
yeah.
And we're looking at those tiny, unimaginably small dots, yeah, that contain this information,
yes, exactly,
on the screen now.
Exactly.
When the dots are decoded, images, video, or just plain text is revealed. So how much data can you store on this material?
Potentially up to 360 terabytes on CD-sized disk.
360 terabytes?
Exactly. About
just on a piece this big?
Exactly.
That's impressive. And how long will it last?
It will last for the duration of the universe, which is about 300 billion years, which is 300 quintillion years. And
quintillion,
yes,
years. So in the right conditions, this will last for the duration of the universe.
Yes, exactly.
And so Microsoft has taken this up. And if you followed the publicity, it was featured at Ignite 2019 as a solution to tape units. And as a demonstration of that, the Superman movie was captured in glass. And as you see there, this is Warner Brothers, VP Brad Collard, CTO, Vicky Kolff, demonstrate what it looks like, a little chip like that, or reels and reels of movies. And of course, just for fun, there's an eternal copy of Asimov in Elon Musk's glove box, which is currently circulating the Earth because he's a genius at publicity. And this takes me back then to that Magna Carta. That's how he wrote it. And that is, if you go to Salisbury Cathedral to see the real thing, next to it you will see a version which is now written in eternal memory. To finish off then, I'm going to just run through some other application to get you thinking. I'm not going to go through all of the technologies that go up to make the devices, but just to point out that quantum technology cannot tolerate loss. And therefore, what you need to do is to choose the lowest loss optical systems that you can find, and sure enough, that's silica. So you see here with flame hydrolysis deposition, UV writing to make waveguides and gratings and various components because it gives you perfect mode matching to fibers. And you see the work that's being done in the UK on quantum entanglement and so on. So that's another emerging market, which appears to be very important. And you see here some devices which have been made, which use this kind of technology, programmable circuits, superconducting single photon detectors, indistinguishable single photon devices, all based on this flexible platform, which is made out of silica. So let me get to answer my initial question. Is there a future for silica? Well, I hope I've managed to persuade you that actually silica is not all done by any means. So it's very hard to beat for optical components, largely because it's a very refractory material. So it's very, very good for environmental stability. It has a low coefficient of expansion, low nonlinearity, high power handling. In fact, it usually is the glass which has the highest of all of these. And of course, with the active doping, you can turn it around and you can make amplifiers, as I pointed out, up to kilowatts, and you can generate and amplify light. So with that, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you again, Sir David. We look forward to seeing where these advanced silica devices will take us. I now have the privilege of introducing this year's co-sponsoring Society Award winners. As a leading optical communication event, OFC serves as a gathering of luminaries in our field. It offers the ideal opportunity to celebrate the accomplishments of our colleagues, and it's my great pleasure to introduce a short presentation from OFC's co-sponsors, IEEE COMSOC, IEEE Photonics Society, and the Optical Society, to recognize this year's award winners for their important contributions to our industry. We are recognizing these individuals for outstanding achievements in their respective fields. These awards and honors will also be presented later today during a special awards ceremony luncheon supported by Corning. We are fortunate to have some of these honorees in the audience today. Will the award winners in attendance please stand? I'd like to take a moment to especially acknowledge the winner of the John Tyndall Award. One of the highest honors in our industry, the Tyndall Award recognizes outstanding contributions to fiber optic technology. The award is co-sponsored by the IEEE Photonics Society and OSA and supported by Corning. For 2020, Raul Bates has been selected as the John Tyndall Award recipient. It is my pleasure to introduce this video sponsored by the two societies for the award that explores his seminal work.
Silicon photonics is an exciting young technology with game-changing potential for high-speed transceiver products, and Raul Bates is one of its foremost pioneers. Raul has earned international recognition as a world-class innovator and educator whose work has had far-reaching impact in areas ranging from telecommunication to medical sensing. Growing up in Belgium, Raul's boyhood interest in designing wood-based machines evolved into a passion for electrical engineering. Optics, electronic IC technology, and biomedical engineering would all intersect in Raul's studies as he earned two master's degrees from Ghent University and from Stanford. At Stanford, he designed his first integrated circuit to help tune a piano, music being another interest. In his free time, Raul played the organ in Stanford's Memorial Church and the Flemish carillon in Hoover Tower. After earning a PhD back home in Ghent, Raul joined IMEC, an independent R&D center committed to advancing state-of-the-art micro and nanotechnologies and serving numerous companies in their innovation roadmap. His team contributed to the development of IMEC's silicon photonics platform, which capitalized on its advanced semiconductor fabrication toolset and know-how. Taking inspiration from the foundry model used in electronics, Raul and his team founded EPIX Fab in 2006 so as to create a multi-project wafer approach for silicon photonics. There, he developed basic components that are now part of the standard toolbox for designers, such as grating couplers. A Ghent faculty member since 1989, Raul is on the team of professors which leads the nearly 100 researchers of the Photonics Research Group. Among its many efforts, this unit has developed concepts for widely tunable semiconductor lasers and created six new companies related to silicon photonics. In recognition of such achievements, King Albert II of Belgium himself paid a visit to Raul's lab. Raul has made groundbreaking contributions to research on photonic integrated circuits, as well as their applications in telecom, datacom, sensing, and medicine. His research today focuses on sensor applications for compact and cost-effective medical devices, like non-invasive devices for prediction of cardiovascular issues. Exploration remains a passion. Whether it's personal travel with his wife and family, or work in the lab and lecture rooms, making discoveries that propel his field and supporting others to do the same. Raul Bates' contributions to the fiber optics and photonics community remain far-reaching and forward-thinking.
Today, Raul is being recognized for seminal research in silicon photonics and for driving the foundry model in this field. We're sorry that Raul was not able to join us in person, but he was able to send us these remarks.
The John Tyndall Award is one of the most significant individual recognitions in the field of optical fiber communications, and I'm truly grateful to anybody who has played a role in the privilege and honor that is conferred to me today. In particular, let me extend this gratitude to the nominator and the endorsers, to the award committee, and to the Optical Society, the IEEE Photonics Society, and to Corning. My team started work in the field of silicon photonics more than 20 years ago, and I'm indebted to many dozens of PhD students and postdocs at Ghent University, as well as to the mastery of IMEC in silicon CMOS technology for making a mark in this field, long before its entry into commercial products. I hoped to be here in person today, but tiny nanoparticles have decided otherwise. I hope and trust that one day silicon photonics will not only serve data centers and telecom networks, but will also enable rapid and affordable detection of viruses, thereby mitigating the societal and economic impact of viral outbreaks. I wish you all a great OFC 2020.
So I know that Raul is watching this live stream, so please join me in congratulating Raul. You may have noticed that we have a special exhibit honoring all Tyndall Award winners here at OFC. It's right outside the registration area across from the Starbucks, in case you haven't seen it. This interactive Tyndall exhibit has a special significance this year as part of our celebration of 50 years of Lightspeed Connections. To share more about this special celebration, I'd like to invite to the stage one of our program chairs, Junshan Wei.
Thank you, Dan. It has been such an honor and pleasure working with my fellow program chairs, David Plant and Shinji Matsuo. I'm sure you're watching remotely, to develop the technical program for OFC this year. As Bob mentioned earlier, for the very first time at OFC, we have enabled remote interactive participation for our attendees and speakers. We're so proud. Because of rapid changing conditions, we accomplished this in record time. Excellent job to the entire team OFC, whether here or remote. What an amazing achievement. is unique in that we're also celebrating the 50th anniversary of the first demonstrations of low-loss optical fiber and room temperature continuous wave semiconductor laser. To mark this anniversary, we will present three special celebration events. The first is a keynote this evening by David Welsh, founder and chief innovation officer of Infinera. The second is a timeline of innovation interactive exhibit on the show floor. The third, as you heard from Dan earlier, is a display in the lobby featuring the John Tyndall Award winners. Programs such as this one can only happen through the generosity and support of our sponsors. In particular, we would like to thank Thor Labs, Kobo, Infi, and Corning. We would also like to acknowledge John Tyndall Award winner, Tom Gelorenzi. Tom. And Jeff Hecht for documenting the milestones in our 50-year timeline of innovation. In addition to honoring our past, we also look forward. Tomorrow afternoon, we will hold a special chair session, Vision 2030, Taking Optical Communications Through the Next Decade. Please attend and learn about emerging hot topics and groundbreaking innovations from the many visionary speakers. I am sure you will enjoy our special additions to this year's program.
Thank you, Shan. It is now my great pleasure to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Chibi, who will tell us about current breakthroughs, challenges, and future evolution in 5G. Dr. B is the president of China Telecom Technology Innovation Center and the CTO of China Telecom Beijing Research Institute. He manages R&D organizations with responsibilities in wireless communications. His 4G innovation project has resulted in a successful deployment in 75% of China Telecom's markets. Dr. B is now responsible for 5G technologies, standardization, and field trials in China Telecom. Today, he'll expound on that experience and discuss the progress in China Telecom's markets. Please extend a warm welcome to Dr. Chibi.
It's my pleasure to be here It's actually my first time here, but also most expensive trip here, considering I have to go through the travel ban and voluntary quarantine and so on. It's all hopefully for the goodness of the 5G, which is the topic I'm going to discuss today. We all know that we have already evolved from 1G to 5G. So what 5G can bring us? Basically, it will give us a very high speed. The speed resembles the hard drive of a PC. It will also, for the first time, be a data-dominated application, and the voice is no longer part of it for now, and will be added on later on. And also, the 5G will not only support the broadband, but also the verticals as well for the first time in history. But of course, the final goal of 5G is to have everything connected through 5G IoT. So we are all hear about the 5G begin to be deployed. Do we know that actually we already have two standard of 5G already? In fact, for the big event of 5G, the Verizon actually announced the 5G plan for the fixed wireless application for the fiber replacement for the fiber to home, and also formed the 5G Open Trial Specification Alliance in 2015 that greatly accelerated the research and the standardization of 5G. And of course, we know that in 2018, the first glimpse of the 5G capability was demonstrated in Korea Winter Olympics. And in the same year, Verizon and AT&T built out the first 5G network to support the fixed wireless in the US and use the OTSA standard. And subsequently, AT&T and other operators also, at the same time, pushed very hard for the 3GPP standard to push through their initial draft of the 5G standard, and which completed by the end of the 2018. And last year, China became the first to deploy and grant the 5G license in the low band, the 3 gigahertz band for mobility applications, use 3GPP standard. And this year, of course, the operators all over the globe try to either deploy large-scale 5G network or accelerate the deployment of 5G. So, in essence, US actually leads the 5G deployment for 28 gigahertz or high frequency band, and China actually leads the deployment of 5G in low frequency band for mobility applications. And in addition, from now on, everyone will be using the 3GPP standard, and the OTSA standard become obsolete. So we have a tremendous progress, actually, last year for 5G. In China, the Chinese government granted four licenses to four operators. Three of them are operating since June of last year for 5G. And China Telecom and China Unicom has about 100 megahertz at 3.5 gigahertz frame. And the China Mobile has 2.5 or 2.6 gigahertz with 160 megahertz bandwidth with a typo here, M should be G. And also, the China Telecom and China Unicom has each built out about 40,000 base stations by the year end, and China Mobile is about 50,000 base stations. And also, the up to date, and China Telecom already have about 8 million subscribers for 5G, and similar can be said for other operators. And China Mobile actually plans to build out 350,000 base stations for 5G by the year end, and hope to attract about 100 million 5G subscribers China Telecom and China Unicom decided to jointly build out their network and to have the size and the number of subscribers either comparable or exceed what the China Mobile will have. So let's look at the 5G's opportunities and challenges. And we all know that 1G, we use the FDM technology. 2G, we use TDMA technology. 3G, we use CDMA technology. 4G and 5G, we use the same OFDM technology. So this made some to wonder, even in the multiple access technology, we may have reached the saturation point. And indeed, we know that Shannon has decomposed our communication system into four components: source code, channel code, and modulation and antenna. And the source code, of course, is the subject of the signal processing society. And for wireless, we basically focus on the last three blocks. That means channel coding, modulation, and antenna. As we all know, for the experts working in this field, the channel coding has not much room to improve. And we are very close to Shannon limit. And for modulation, as we just previously said, that it also appears to be in the saturation point. So the most of the potential actually for wireless is in the antenna areas. And get the innovations in wireless actually gets more and more difficult. And if we look at Shannon's formula for the communication in terms of data rate, you can see that 5G actually utilized all kinds of technologies by using the UDN and to increase the number of cells, by use the massive MIMO to greatly increase the number of channels simultaneously, by expand the bandwidth from 20 megahertz to 100 megahertz and so on, and by using technologies that do the interference management and noise reduction, of course, by the beamforming of the technology. Among all these technologies, actually, massive MIMO becomes the trademark of 5G technology, and which provided the most gains and above all the other technologies. So, and if we look what we have done so far, we can see that the spectral efficiency increased about threefold generation by generation. And the peak efficiency increased about five times from generation to generation. We did not see any saturations inside. So we would say the research community did a great job when we're doing the 5G. Then the SS specification, ITU actually gave about eight KPIs for 5G. And these five KPIs are very familiar with for most of the experts working in the area. However, I would divide the eight specifications into three categories. One is called accomplished. And indeed, in the mobility area, in the user speed area, and the efficiency, we achieved our objective. And we also have a category called reachable. In terms of density and the number of connections, you just have to buy more hardware. So if you spend money, you can achieve it, no problem. And also for the delay, as I will discuss later, is achievable if we want to spend money. And of course, there are a category you never heard of in the media. It's called not reached. And for example, the energy, the goal was to improve 100 times. I don't know where the numbers come from, and it's Dreamland number, and we did not reach. And I think we did improvement, I think within about 10 times, and never been 100 times. And also the peak rate, the objective is about 20 gigahertz. We did have a demo of 20 gigahertz, but it's not going to be in commercial system because it's too expensive, and also we don't have the bandwidth for that. So those are the three categories. And actually, for the 5G, for the first time in history, we have multiple applications. And the one we are familiar with is the broadband application. We call that the enhanced mobile broadband. And also, in this time, we added machine-to-machine communication to hope to have everything connected. And in addition, we have a ultra-reliable and low-latency communication that's geared for the vertical and the industry. So as we can see, we have a very solid base for the business case, which is broadband from generation to generation. And we also have new two pillars of applications for vertical applications. Now, for the evolution of 5G, we all heard a lot about the race of the 5G between countries, and also how good the 5G is by one standard. However, I'm here to tell you that the 5G is not that just one standard. In fact, in the world, the operators are building out the 5G is actually 5G for release 15. The release 15 can only support the eMBB application. And in China, we use a 3.5 gigahertz TDD system for that. And in the future, we have to deploy the release 16 of 3GPP standard. That's geared to support the URLLC low latency application. And in the far future, we will expected to build another release, not yet known, that support MMTC application. So as you can see, 5G is one standard, but it's not one system, but it is a multiple system evolution with deployment phases. And to put it bluntly, we actually currently, all the operators are buying 5G. And that 5G is actually release 15, which can support eMBB. In China, as I said, we use the 3.5 gigahertz and the TDD system. And in the future, in fact, we will have to buy another hardware system, not software upgradable, and release 16, and that will support URLLC. And that system is most likely to use FDD system, as I will discuss later. And in China Telecom, we plan to use 2.1 gigahertz for that. And in the future, we may yet to have to buy another hardware system to support the MMTC. So as you can see, that the hybrid future of 5G by one unified standard actually requires three separate hardware system to support. Gee, why that's the case? Why we need three system support one standard? Must be something is wrong. Let me explain to you a little bit. Okay, first let's go through the IoT and machine to machine. Okay, machine to machine, for the success of the machine to machine communication, there are three criteria which is most important: coverage, cost, and battery. So let's see how 5G stack against these three criteria. We know 5G will be deployed in the world at high frequencies. The higher the frequency, the more attenuation of the airwave, and therefore not good for coverage. Cost, 5G we now know is going to be more CapEx expensive and also OpEx expensive. So from a cost viewpoint, it does not have much advantage. Battery life, 5G is more complex, actually will consume more power. We all know that for 4G, we all also have this battery, extra battery in our pocket. 5G, you will need more, okay? So for that case, we know that the 5G, current 5G is not good for IoT. We need to rebuild a new system, which is better than our current system in order to support the IoT. Now, for the low delay system for the industry, we know the communication is duplex, two-way street, okay? And currently, the deported 5G system actually is TDD, called the time division duplex. It's more or less like the single rail train system. You have to wait one way to complete before another way can begin. And it takes about 2 milliseconds for that. And we also have FDD frequency division duplex. It's a more like two-way, two-rail train system. You don't need to wait. So it's much faster, no waiting between, and it's more suited for low latency application. That's why I said previously, you would need another system, which is called FDD, to support URLC. So as you can see, that's already two reasons. So the we summarize the categories of the 5G, and we have a TDD system in 28 gigahertz high frequencies deployed by the US for the fixed wireless application. We have 5G TDD systems in sub 6 gigahertz in China, 3.5 for China Telecom and Unicom, 2.6 gigahertz for China Mobile. That can support the EMBB mobility application. Then we know that we have to deploy in the future FDD system to support the URLC low latency application. And in the future, we don't know which release in 3GPP, we will have MMTC system that can satisfy the three criteria for success. And so as you can see, we have four categories of access system for 5G. Not to mention, we also have the fiber optic system access network to support home broadband. So indeed, I think we definitely need a better integrated approach by design and in order to unify all the access systems. Otherwise, it's a real burden of the operators to have with CapEx and OpEx for all those number of systems. And that's one of the reasons I'm here to talk to you today to see whether we can have actually integrated approach rather than the independent approach in the standard and in the community. So the joint deployment of 5G has already been considered by operators. Now we can see that all CapEx and OpEx of the 5G, we know now is much more expensive than 4G. Basically because of the hardware, the complexity is greatly increased. And also we know that we have multiple application require multiple systems and so forth. So it's so big that we really need more revenue to support our deployment of so many systems. However, the revenues, new revenues from 5G is by no means certain. And in this case, in fact, the operators begin to consider more about the collaboration rather than pure competition to solve this problem. And China Telecom currently are leading this effort to jointly build out the 5G network with its competitor, China Unicom, to serve the 5G. So joint deployment may have also complications and implications for the optical system design as well. And because once it's combined and they have a different characteristic that you have to think about. And so let's look at the what the 5G will bring us in the field. And we heard all about 5G and 20 gigabit per second. And we did the testing with 100 megahertz bandwidth in China. We probably can get about 1.5 gigabit per second and in the downlink, and about 200 something megabit per second for the uplink. And this is going to be what you can have in the commercial system, not the theoretical ones that can be supported by the standard. And as for the delay, in fact, people talk about 5G will give you very low delay, not necessarily for this version. For release 15 that we're going to build right now, and we actually have the version that can support only EMBB. For EMBB, as you can see, the measured delay is between 3 to 4 milliseconds. And for 5G, the specification is about 4 milliseconds maximum. And if you look at 4G, it is about 5 milliseconds maximum. So 5G is expected to slightly improve the delay, not significantly. Okay. So, and if we further break down the delays, we can see that we always know that for the most user, we think the 5G and 4G is always on. But in fact, when we do the design, this is always off because you want to save battery life and you want the channel to be shared by others. So most time your mobile is in idle. When you first that from idle to active, when you get a call or when you want to send something, it takes about 50 milliseconds. And 5G, to reduce that delay, introduce a new state, which is inactive to active. So in this case, it takes about 16 milliseconds to wake up. And if we do a PIN used as a broadband application, it takes about a round trip of 6 milliseconds. And only if you use FDD system to do URL C release 16, you get a round trip of 1.6 milliseconds for the 5G, which satisfies ITU's definition of URL C application, which is less than 1 millisecond one-way delay or 2 millisecond round trip. So we say that it is achievable, but it requires to build another system called FDD system. Okay. In addition to the three systems, we also have the NSA and SA deployment strategy. And for 5G in China, use 3.5 gigahertz for China Telecom and China Unicom. And our coverage is about comparable to 4G because we use low frequencies at 3.5. And our 5G, our 4G is in the 1.8 gigahertz, not too far away. And China Telecom is currently pushing the world to adopt the standalone SA strategy. In this case, 5G will be ubiquitously covered everywhere. And in the US, and China, the Verizon and AT&T, and they use 28 gigahertz, which is a very high frequency, very high attenuation. And therefore, they almost like a hotspot application. In this case, they use 4G as a base coverage, and they use 5G on top of that for hotspot. So in this case, it's called non-standalone because 5G cannot stand alone. So that's a different strategy. And of course, the 5G growth also greatly stimulated the deployment of fiber optics network as well. We already know that we had a boom for the 4G area for the fiber networks, and the same will happen for the 5G. In fact, we in this 5G system has three places you can use fiber optic systems. It's called the front haul, middle haul, and back haul. So that's all good news for the growth of the optical industry. And so 5G, what will 5G bring for our average people? We all use the GPS navigators in the past. But guess what? More and more, they don't use anymore. And it's replaced by the cell phone. Why? Previously, storage is cheaper than transmission. Now, the transmission is cheaper than the storage. So this actually, the speed of the 3G and 4G made the difference such that they changed our life. And we expect the same will happen in 5G. We all used to use USBs. The speed for USB 2, most popular one, is about 500 megabit per second. We also are very used to the hard drive in our PC, is about 800 megabit per second. And 4G is not quite there, although it's reasonably good, but for 5G, as you can see, they are comparable to our USB and the hard drive. So this will greatly change our expectation and our life and our user habit and will generate new opportunities and services that you cannot imagine in the past. And also, the 5G has stimulated the growth of the chipset. And in 3G, we use the 65 nanometer technology. 4G is 28. And 5G, we use 7 nanometer, and Qualcomm just announced that the second generation of 5G chipset will be 5 nanometer technology. And 6G, we expect to be even lower. So as you can see that the 5G and the next gen system actually greatly stimulate the chipset development, and also made the very expensive for the chipset, and only mega vendors can play the game, and the small vendors are gone. And we are familiar with the cost curve for electronics, and as you can see, US and China is a leader, and the leader has the advantage to pay here price, and the rest of the world pay lower price. So as you can see, handset is gets more expensive, and we need the volume to bring it down. And the 5G, just like 4G, require a very healthy ecosystem because we are actually connected. Now, if we look at the curve again, it's not really the years. It's the volume that actually dictated the decline of the price curve. And 28 gigahertz, due to United States government's export control and trade war, actually, the 28 gigahertz is not doing well in the world. And it actually began to affect its ecosystem and also the volume and therefore the price. And the low frequencies are doing very well around the world. And it's actually on the different scale for the handset. So we say that the growth and the handset cost of the 28 gigahertz actually is impacted by the trade war, which is not a good thing. I see that I'm running out of time, and the good news that I have just published a paper in IEEE Communications Magazine in December of last year. You can look to that paper. It gives much more details on what the topic I'm talking about today, and there are lots of reasons why the capex expense is so high, why OPEX is so high, and so forth. And it's titled The 10 Trends in the Cellular Industry and an Outlook on 6G. Okay, so in conclusion, we say that 5G and the next gen system will provide growth and for wireless and optical industry as well. And there are lots of opportunities. And the ever growing data rate of the 5G is expected to revolutionize the way we live and do business and provide new services and also new areas to do business. So 5G access system is actually getting more and more expensive. And therefore, vendors need to take a thoughtful thinking as to how we can do an integrated approach instead of an independent approach so that we can have a much better handle on the system integration. Currently, operators like China Telecom, we bundle wireless to wireless, but wireline and wireless, but it's still two systems. And we see that we have a separate standard body, separate research community, and this is the first time I come here, I work in wireless. So we really need to better integrate. And also operators now need to think about collaborations now in addition to competition, because otherwise they may have difficulty to deploy the system. So also, as I said, with the ever-growing complexity of the 5G and including next-gen system like 6G we're working on, the handsets and the chipsets get more and more expensive, and we need a healthy global ecosystem to support, to succeed. And the protectionism and will hurt the growth. Okay, that's my presentation. Thank you very much.
Benno Wilke from the research group leader at the Max Planck Institute for Gravitational Physics in Germany. Dr. Wilke represents on behalf of Karsten Donsman, who could not attend. Dr. Wilke is a pioneer in the use of laser technology for the terrestrial-based LIGO project, which was heralded for the first verification of gravitational waves from massive black hole collisions in far distant galaxies. He is now very much involved in the next generation of the ground-based study. This effort will go even beyond current detection to answer outstanding astrophysical questions about the early formation of the universe and its ongoing evolution. Please hang around for this talk. It is fascinating. Please join me in welcoming to OFC Dr. Benno Wilke. Go get him.
Good morning. Thanks for having me here. Let me start with bringing you best regards from Karsten Donsman, who really regrets that he cannot be here. The second thing that I would say up front is that even though here's my name on the slides, I'm reporting on work that has been done by more than thousands of people from the LIGO collaboration, the GEO collaboration, the Virgo collaboration, the CAGA collaboration, and the LISA collaboration. So let me start with an outline of my talk. I will talk to you about an event that happened 1.3 billion years ago. Two massive black holes spiraled around each other and finally merged. These black holes each had the mass of 30 times our sun. At the end of their life, they spiraled around each other faster than 100 hertz. That's the spinning cycle of your washing machine. These massive objects acquired the speed of 0.5, half the speed of light. So that's really a very strong, even catastrophic event. Now, that produced some ripples in space-time, and I'll explain a little bit more what that means. And they propagated through space at the speed of light and hit Earth in September 2015. On Earth, they made the length of an interferometer arm 4 kilometers long to change by a thousandth part of a proton diameter, and we were able to measure that, and that really was a breakthrough and started a new type of astronomy, gravitational wave astronomy. In our second observing run, we saw another kind of source. This time we saw neutron stars, two neutron stars spiraled around each other and merged, and we had the chance to really get a good sky resolution. We could point electromagnetic telescope, optical telescope, to this patch in the sky, and more than 70 telescopes stopped the measurement campaign and looked at this patch in the sky. And all of them, some earlier, some later, saw a new source in the sky, a kilonova, and that really marked a breakthrough in multi-messenger astronomy. We have a wealth of science coming out of this one event. Currently, we have something like a few events per week, but we want more. And at the end of my talk, I'll explain to you what we plan to do in terms of next generation detectors on ground and in space. Now, let me start by talking a little bit about this ripples in space-time. To do that, we have to look at gravitation. Gravitation, Newton said, well, all masses exert an attractive force upon each other, and that's the reason why the apple doesn't fall down under. Einstein changed this concept by saying, no, gravitation is not a force, but it's a property of space. He furthermore said that matter determines how space bends, and space determines how matter moves. We often illustrate this space-time as a two-dimensional membrane, as you can see here, and it's quite simple to imagine that if you put a mass in there, it bends the space-time, and the space-time deformation now tells how the moon is supposed to move around Earth. But the space-time does not only bend its coordinates, it as well bends light rays.
that we know since 1978. The effect is called gravitational lensing. And here you can see what that means. If we are on Earth and we observe a galaxy far away, and in between us and this galaxy, we have another heavy object, another galaxy that bends space-time, then you can see that the light rays are now curved. And that produces multiple images of this galaxy, as you can see here. All right, let's now have a look at a patch in the sky and imagine that we put our two black holes just in front of that. Then they bend the rays, and the pattern looks like this. Okay, none of the stars moved, just the light rays are bent, and that's what space-time can do. These two black holes are obviously not stable in that configuration, so what they do is they circle around each other, and what happens to our gravitational lens? All stars seem to move, but they don't. All stars stay where they were, just the space-time curvature, the space-time bends and causes this dynamic situation. All right, let me now go away from gravitational lensing and really have a look at this space-time. Here, we now have an animation where we see the space-time strength change in space-time by color-coded or by elevation of this simulation. This simulation is slowed down by a factor of 40. So in reality, these guys move 40 times faster around each other, and you can see that the strength is increasing, and the space-time curvature has a very strong shape, and we see that some kind of waves emerge. These waves in the space-time are called, the ripples that I'm talking about are called gravitational waves. Here we see them again in a different animation, and we see how these waves come about, and now they travel through space, 1.3 billion years at the speed of light. And at some point in time, actually September 2015, they hit Earth. Now they hit Earth, and you can see the effect of these gravitational waves on Earth. They deform the Earth from a sphere to a football in one direction, then the football in another direction. Luckily, this is vastly exaggerated. Now let's have a closer look at this effect. Let's imagine we have an arrangement of masses, three masses. We point our coordinate system to this mass. Then the effect of a gravitational wave is that it changes one length and makes it longer, the other shorter, and that 180 degrees out of phase. That's the effect of a gravitational wave, and that happens with the frequency of the gravitational wave. Now the strength, I said, those are ripples in space-time. They are tiny, tiny, tiny ripples. If we imagine that this length here is the distance between Sun and Earth, then the distance change caused by the gravitational wave is just the diameter of an atom. Tiny. Now, you might say, and you guys were able to detect that. Well, let me project that to our measurement distance, interferometers with 4 kilometer arm lengths. Now, this length change is not the diameter of a hair, not the diameter of an atom, not the diameter of a proton, it's 1/1000th of the diameter of a proton that we were able to measure, and here you can see the signals. This is a time series of the strain. The strain is the strength of the gravitational wave, as we measured this with the two LIGO detectors, one in Livingston, the other one in Hanford, shifted by 7 milliseconds. That's the time delay between those. And you can see that there are signals in the noise. We were surprised that they were so large that we could see them. Signals in the noise, and if you look at the time here, you might imagine that this frequency that we see here is in the audio range. And that allows us now to play a sound file of this time series. And that means we can now hear the universe, and here's how it sounds. The short whoop, whoop, those were our black holes colliding. What we see here is a spectrogram. Here's the time, here's the frequency, and you can see that the frequency increases up to several hundred hertz before the merger. So this clearly marked the start of gravitational wave astronomy. Let me now explain to you how we were able to measure that. We take an interferometer, a light source, split the beam. The beam comes back, interferes, and depending on the arm length difference, we get a bright or a dark part. That can only happen because electromagnetic waves are electromagnetic waves which can interfere. So if we have a positive peak and a positive peak coming together at the same time, we get a bright fringe. If a positive and a negative peak come together at the same time, they cancel. And that brings us to this bright and dark part here. The strength of the gravitational wave, which we call strain, H here is a relative length change over, so it's a delta L over L. If we change this formula around, then you see that our measurement task, measuring delta L, is H times L. So for a given strain H, the measurement task gets easier if we make our interferometer long. And that's the reason why we use these interferometers, which are 4 kilometer long arm lengths. Okay, if we now look at the output of an interferometer, here's the normalized output power over the differential arm length. That's the difference between the arm lengths here in units of the wavelength. Then we see this cosine square curve, a bright and a dark fringe if the round trip arm length changes by half a wavelength, and we use 1 micrometer light. Now, if we have a gravitational wave, this is a time series. We move up and down this curve and convert this differential length change time series into power time change that we can measure with a photodiode. As I told you, we are not measuring differences of wavelengths, but of a small fraction of that. So what we need to do is really we need to zoom into this area here quite a bit. Let me do that. So here we are. Now we want to measure 10 to minus 19 meters. That will cause the power to change by 6 times 10 to minus 13 of the power that we have in the interferometer. Now this power in the interferometer carries some shot noise, which scales as a square root of this power. And if you do the math, then you only get a positive signal to noise ratio if you have powers circulating in the interferometer of 100 kilowatts or more. Now, even with the lasers that we heard about earlier, we cannot get these numbers in the interferometer, so we need to have a special optical layout of our interferometer. We use optical cavities. If we have an optical cavity, then we always see that if this cavity is resonant, we get some power buildup in the cavity. The circulating power is much larger than the power that we inject, so we put cavities in the interferometer arms here. We put our interferometer to the dark fringe. That means no light leaves the interferometer here. But then all the light has to go back towards the laser. So the whole interferometer behaves as if it was a mirror. One mirror, and we put a second mirror here, another optical cavity that we call power recycling. And that allows us that starting with a laser of 165 watts, we get circulating light powers in the final design stage of roughly 800 kilowatts in the arms. We can do a similar trick for the signal. Assume that we have a signal causing power modulation side pans to leave the interferometer. Then we can put another mirror there, inject the light back, get this power buildup, and see larger signal down here. So those tricks we use to increase the signal that we see here, the power modulation of the light caused by the gravitational wave. Unfortunately, there's not only the signal, there's as well noise. Here we can see some of the noise sources that we have to fight: power and frequency noise of the laser, shot noise I mentioned already, thermal noise, which moves the surface of our mirror around, seismic ground motion, the ground moves much more than the length change that we want to detect, and index of refraction fluctuations in the arms. And let me concentrate on a few of those sources and tell you how we mitigate those. The index of refraction fluctuations in the arms are caused by motion of gas or molecules fluctuations in the arms, so we put everything into a vacuum system. Here you can see the central area of the LIGO, one of the LIGO detectors, tall vacuum tanks holding the optics. The 4 kilometers are covered by a beam tube, 1.2 meter in diameter. And here you can see how it looks inside these vacuum tanks. For the ground motion, we use harmonic oscillators. Harmonic oscillators have the feature that they attenuate motion above the resonant frequencies, and we all know that from our car. So we start using spring dashboard combinations, as we do in the car, to attenuate the ground motion to this level. Another one here. And from here, we suspend now pendula. And let me show you how a pendulum can attenuate motion. Let's assume my little tennis ball here was the mirror. And my hand is now the suspension point of this pendulum. Okay, if I now move the suspension point around, you see that the mirror is following. But we are not going to measure that slow motion of the differential arm, but at 10 hertz. Let me now simulate that the ground shakes at 10 hertz. Look at the suspension point, the amplitude, and look at the mirror. You can clearly see that the mirror is moving much less than the suspension point, and that's the effect that we use for isolating ground motion. We do this sequentially, so in total, for the LIGO detectors, 4 pendulum stages. And by this system here, we attenuate the ground motion at 10 hertz by 10 orders of magnitude. And that's what is required to measure the gravitational wave. We need to use very high quality optics and very high mechanical quality to reduce thermal noise. That's the reason why we have the full lower stage, the penultimate mass, and the mirror itself made from fused silica, connected by fused silica fibers with a diameter of roughly 400 micrometers to get the mechanical quality factor high, and by that, the thermal noise low. Let me talk a little bit about lasers, and I plan to talk about high-power lasers, which I don't dare anymore after the first talk in the morning, so let me say what is special about these lasers that we use. We need lasers with a power of roughly 200 watts, single frequency, single mode, linearly polarized, and high power, and very low noise in all parameters. For experts, we need power noise of 10 to minus 8 per root hertz. We need relative frequency noise of 10 to minus 17 per root hertz. Fraction in higher order modes of less than 1%, and the pointing of the beam 4 kilometers away has to be smaller than 0.2 millimeters. We built low power lasers in Hanover, and by now all gravitational wave detectors either use or will use the lasers that we built and stabilized in Hanover at my institute in Germany. And even though these are low noise, we need further stabilization. We need several control loops for frequency stabilization, several control loops for power stabilization, nested loops before we inject the light into the vacuum. Another thing that we pioneered in Germany with our gravitational wave detector GS600 is the injection of squeezed light into these interferometers. If we look at the quantum noise or the shot noise, then this can be described by vacuum fluctuation of the light entering the dark port. And as this behaves as a mirror, they come back and cause noise on the photodetector. If we are now able to change these vacuum fluctuations, to squeeze them down in one quadrature, then we can see the small little error, the signal that was buried in noise over here. We were able to demonstrate that in GEO, that's now implemented in LIGO and in Virgo. And here you can see the sensitivity curve of one of these gravitational wave detectors. This is the strain, the noise spectral density over frequency. the black curve is without squeezing and the green curve is with squeezing, and that improves the sensitivity by quite a bit. All right. Now, even if we have all these noise sources reduced, we can still not see the signal in here, so what we need is sophisticated data analysis methods. We take these signals coming from the two detectors, we calibrate them, and now we compare them with pre-calibrated templates. We calculate 200,000 waveforms, and now we do a matched filtering, the same as FBI does with fingerprints, and try to find a match. Once we found a match, then we compare the template, whether it was the same in both detectors, and then we have gravitational wave candidate. And that we did for the source that I mentioned, these two 30 solar mass black holes. Here you can see the measurement, here you can see the template with the best match, and the residual is very small, so this seems to describe what happened in the universe. And if we now go back and look at what kind of parameters we use to calculate this particular template, then here, what we have. We have a primary black hole mass of 36 and 29, the final mass of 62, and more information about the source. You might recognize that there are three solar masses missing if you do the sum. The energy of three solar masses was radiated away in this event, so it was the most violent event in the universe that we know of. That's much more than the bright, than the known universe emits in electromagnetic waves in that time frame. This got us a cover of Physical Review. It got us more than 960 cover storage in newspapers, and in 2017, the Nobel Prize was awarded for this discovery. So this clearly marks gravitational wave astronomy. Gravitational wave exists. We can hear the dark side of the universe. Einstein's general relativity seems to describe these signals well in the strong field limit. These black holes with masses larger than 10 solar masses exist, and we now start gravitational astronomy. But for astronomy, you want to have more than one source, and in our second observing run, we had more than one source. We have now, from the second and first observing run, we have now 10 in spirals. Here are the solar masses that in spiral and merge into this. We have 10 such events, and that starts really, that we can now look at what are the progenitors of these solar masses and do astronomy with them. You might realize that there's one small thing down here, and we were lucky at the end of the second observing run to see this. This is the merger of two neutron stars. Here you can see now a time series of the Fermi gamma ray detector and the LIGO gravitational wave detector. And I play the sound again. These are now the neutron stars who merge, and you will listen now to the merger of neutron stars. And this ping, that was the detection of the Fermi satellite. A gamma ray burst was detected. Now, this was amazing. We were able, from the gravitational waves, to really determine the position in the sky to 30 degrees. And immediately, optical telescopes started to look into that area. And they really found a source here which wasn't there before that event. 70 telescopes in space and on Earth started this measurement campaign and got a wealth of science out. So we saw these signals in gravitational waves, gamma rays, X-rays, UV, optical, IR, and radio. So radio and UV folks and X-ray folks really had to wait for 10 days until they saw it. But as a reward, they were able to observe them. This is a light source for more than a year by now. Okay, here's the light curve and how it changes over the first days. So this is from 0.5 to 2 microns. You can see that this source is quite dynamic, and from that we can learn a lot about what is happening and what kind of mass is ejected. This clearly marks a breakthrough in multi-messenger astronomy. It confirms that gravitational waves and GRBs are connected from neutron star merger. Trilateration allowed us to point to this patch in the sky where optical telescopes could look at. We figured out that the gravitational wave travel was the speed of light. We were able to determine the Hubble constant in a completely different way, using an effect called standard sirens. And we have now an idea what the elements were that were produced in this. There were many, many heavy elements produced, and it wasn't clear where the heavy elements larger with masses larger than iron come from, like gold and platinum. And now, to our current understanding, we think that in this event, this single merger, roughly 15% of the mass of the Earth was produced in gold. Okay, so this is really kind of a big source for heavy elements. Currently, we are in the third observing run. We have two detectors in the US, one in Germany, one in Italy. One in Japan will be coming up soon, and we are starting a construction of another one in India. And these detectors have now, in the third observing run, detected another 59 events. These events are event candidates. We haven't done all the analysis, so we cannot say that they are real, but a good fraction of these 59s will be real gravitational wave events. Okay, that is now starting really to be astronomy. But we want more. This here corresponds to a current event rate of roughly 2 events per week. We want to improve the sensitivity here, the advanced LIGO sensitivity, by an order of magnitude that gives a reach a factor of 10 further into the distance, and that corresponds to a volume which is 1,000 times larger. And that will give us event rates of several hundreds per day. But we want even more. We want to go to lower frequencies, as you can see here. That means heavier masses. Or we will see these neutron stars now hours before they merge. And we can tell our friends with the optical telescopes, guys, 3 hours over there, there will be neutron star merger. Point your telescope, you'll see something. So that's what we want. And let me now try to tell you how we can get there. One concept is the Cosmic Explorer concept. That's a US-based concept, and the main idea is to make the interferometer longer. The idea here is to make the interferometer arm now 40 kilometers instead of 4 kilometers. Use mainly the same type of technology that we have, and in the second stage, make it cryogenic. There's a different concept that the Europeans follow, because we don't have 40-kilometer-long patches without, you know, villages in between. So we plan to go underground and build a infrastructure, a triangular-shaped infrastructure, which will hold a total of 6 interferometers, one set for low frequencies, the other set for high frequencies, and that will then combine the sensitivity curve and bring us to these low frequencies. There's one more thing that we are working on since many years, and it's really coming to be real now, and that is the LISA mission. That is the Laser Interferometric Space Antenna. Here we plan to fly a constellation of 3 satellites, roughly 20 degrees behind the Earth, following the Earth around the Sun. And remember, the measurement task gets easier the longer we make our interferometer. These interferometer arms will be 2.5 million kilometers. That will give us a huge wealth of new sources that we can detect. We can detect then the collision of supermassive black holes. Here's the sensitivity again, now over frequencies, and here's 1 hertz, 100 millihertz, 10 millihertz, so we're getting now to orbit times of an hour, which we need for these supermassive black holes. This here is a prediction of a binary merger of 2 10 million mass supermassive black holes. We see them for days in our spectrum, slightly lighter, just million solar mass black holes will stay there for months, and some even for a year. We see many, many of galactic binaries, some of which we know already, and they we can use as verification binaries, and we will see the LIGO sources here in this spectrum already. So we can follow them from here, then they leave the spectrum and come to the LIGO spectrum, and that will tell us a lot about the evolution of these gravitational waves. Let me conclude now. Due to the immense progress in optical technology and interferometry, we measured these gravitational waves, and that gave really birth to gravitational wave astronomy. We can now hear the universe. The detection of the merging neutron stars was a major breakthrough in multi-messenger astronomy, and I think the combination of gravitational wave detection and electromagnetic detection has a great potential for discoveries and for understanding the science of these astronomical objects. And I tried to describe to you that we are planning the third generation detectors on ground and in space, and they will give us a much deeper insight into the universe. And honestly, I think there will be surprises. Whenever we opened a new window to the universe, there were surprises, and I'm pretty sure there will be some coming from gravitational wave and multi-messenger astronomy as well. And on this positive note, let me stop and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Wilka, for being with us today and share your insights on gravitational waves. That concludes our session. The exhibit is now open. Please enjoy the full conference and the special session. Thank you again.